Okay.
We can hear you.
Excellent. All right, item number one, we'll open the meeting up. Item number one is consideration of resolution 22202-41, a resolution declaring that the Franklin Municipal Planning Commission and Board of Mayor and Aldermen shall meet on April 23rd, 2020 and conduct its essential business by electronic means rather than being required to gather a quorum of the members physically present in the same location because it's necessary to protect the health, safety, and welfare of Tennesseans in the light of COVID-19 outbreak.
This item.
Just wishes to speak on this item.
There are no public comments on the phone line or by email.
Okay, thank you. All right, I'm going to need a motion and a second.
Move for approval, Scott.
Is there a second?
Second.
Second, who is that?
Jimmy.
Thank you, Jimmy. All right, then I'm gonna go through the roll call. Marcia Allen.
Aye.
Jimmy Franks.
Aye.
Scott Harrison.
Aye.
Roger Lindsay. Is Roger with us?
He is not.
Okay. Alma McLemore.
Aye.
Michael Orr.
Aye.
Ann Peterson.
She is currently joining the meeting.
Jennifer Solaji.
Aye.
Bev Berger.
Present.
Dana McClendon. Scott Speedy.
Present.
Margaret Martin.
Aye.
All right, the ayes have it. Oh, I'm sorry, we still have more. Page two, Clyde Barnhill. Pearl Bransford. And Brandy Blanton. All right, motion passes. The Board of Mayor and Aldermen and Franklin Municipal Planning Commission joint workshop will limit physical access in the meeting room due to COVID limitations. I'm sorry, COVID. Current limitations on public gatherings to prevent further spread of COVID-19 and to protect the health, safety, and welfare of the City of Franklin officials, staff, and citizens. The purpose of this meeting will be to conduct a project review workshop. No decisions on applications will be made at this meeting. Accommodations have been made to ensure that the public is able to participate in the meeting. The public may participate in the following ways. Watch the meeting on Franklin TV or the City of Franklin website. Watch the live stream through the City of Franklin Facebook and YouTube accounts. Call 615-550-8220 to listen to the meetings or voice a comment during the public comment period. The public may email comments to planning intake, planningintake, at franklintn.gov to be read aloud during the meeting. Emailed comments will be accepted until 1 hour prior to the meeting. Limited viewing will be available in the lobby of City Hall to watch live video. All right, let's go to item number two.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Real quick, the phone number, I think you may have said it wrong, just accidentally. It's 615-550-8420.
That is it, and I said it wrong. Sorry. Okay. Item two, discussion of a development plan proposing 995,884 square feet of commercial uses, including 605 hotel keys, 530,000 square feet of existing office use and 1,624 multifamily and townhome dwelling units on 49.93 acres located near the intersection of Carruthers Parkway and Mayfield Drive, East Works PUD. We'll now turn the screen over to the applicant. Then after their presentation, I'll open up for discussion. To ensure everyone has the opportunity to speak, I'll call on you individually to ask if you have a comment for the applicant. Staff?
The applicant can go ahead and begin their presentation.
Okay.
Share screen ability should be there.
Thank you very much. We really appreciate the opportunity to be in front of you tonight. I'll have some introductory remarks, then I'll hand it over to Brian. My name is Dirk Malton. I'm the development director for Market Street Enterprises. We're the applicant for this tonight. Just wanted to say a couple things to get us started. First, you'll notice that I painted the logo for our project on the wall of my den. So we're really invested in this project. Very serious about being a very good community member here in the city of Franklin. First and foremost, we hope everyone is safe and well tonight with everything that's going on. We're very grateful that the city is in business and is conducting their business electronically and making the effort to help us and others move along the agenda for the Board of Mayor and Aldermen. And from a personal note, I cannot be more excited to be back in front of you again with what we think is a really great project. We've had a tremendous collaboration with everybody at the city from planning and engineering all the way up and down the municipality, and I think what Brian's going to show tonight is the result of that collaboration, perfectly in line with the new zoning ordinance that was passed in December with Envision Franklin, and we're very anxious to get the project moving with all the great help that we've had here today. So with that, I'll turn it over to Brian. Thank you.
Brian, I think you're still on mute.
There we go. Thank you so much for that, Mike. That would have been a very boring presentation. Thanks for the time tonight. Glad to be back in front of you all. I'm going to throw my screen up here, and we're going to run through this presentation pretty quickly so we can get to the important part, which is the discussion with all of you. So let me do that here. All right. View, full screen. Can you see my screen now? Yes, okay, great. So if you recall, we've been before you in the past about this project. The good news is that we're here really with an update. We were starting the process officially with the new zoning ordinance, but the plan has remained, for all intents and purposes, intact in its fundamentals. So I'm gonna run you through some of it, will be a refresher just to remind you of where we are, and then some of it will be things that we're asking based on the new zoning ordinance. If you recall, the site is located between Carruthers Parkway and 65 here, Bakers Bridge and Cool Springs Boulevard. It is the Ford Motor Credit building, or old Primus building. From the beginning of this project, we dove into Envision Franklin, wanted to make sure that this project was really the embodiment of all of the concepts and ideas within Envision Franklin. And then furthermore, with the new zoning ordinance that's been put in place recently, it was actually really quite a joy to work on the project this time around. Last time with the old ordinance, we were really trying to shoehorn some things in, and the ordinance didn't work well. This time it's a lot easier to work with and make the project make sense. So appreciate that. If you recall, the site is, heavily graded and designed for a conventional suburban office park. And some of those features on the site have made it a challenging to try to preserve and protect the existing vegetation and topography, but we've worked really hard to do that, and we'll show you in the plan how that works. Here you go, here's zooming in, roughly 50 acres, about 500,000 square feet of office in the middle, and about a lot of asphalt and paving. And so what we wanted to do was to preserve the existing building because it's functioning well, and create an immersive environment, a neighborhood around that that worked well with it and stood alone as well. This is the plan as it stands now. If you're, have been studying the old plan, it'll take you a minute to actually notice the differences, and I'm really thankful for that. One of the major differences is we've actually included, created this outer loop road, and this is part of the collaboration that Dirk referred to with engineering, the fire department. This helps provide a lot of services, utilities, easier access for emergency vehicles, et cetera. So that's a new addition. And for the most part, though, we continue to have a mixed-use core around this large park area with the existing tree stand that we've saved. We want to have office buildings, which are in the orange here, and then where they interface with the main commercial area, having some mixed use or other public uses on the ground floor. The purple areas represent potential hotel locations. And again, those would have outward facing ground floor that would hopefully be activated. We've also incorporated the existing building, even though it's a conventional suburban office building. We've worked to create public spaces that work well with the rest of the neighborhood. And then even things like trying to turn the cafe cafeteria inside out and make it a cafe to activate that side of the street. We have intimate pedestrian spaces throughout plazas and parks and greenways, you know, courtyards for the residents so they can get out. And then also incorporating our sustainable stormwater components into the project, not only at the edges, but also throughout the development. So there's, I could go on for hours about the plan, but hopefully you get the idea, and we'll be happy to answer more questions about that later. The most important thing to realize is that as much as we might like it to happen, this isn't going to happen overnight. So the idea is a 10 to 20 year build out, and we have included a phasing plan so you can start to see phase 1, 2, 3, 4, so on and so forth, and how this would lay out from a infrastructure perspective as well as a development perspective. And that phasing concept is really important to make sure we understand also the impacts over time. From the beginning, as we were studying Envision Franklin and looking at what was important to it and the core components of it, community character came up over and over again, and that is from, you know, from our firm's perspective and development team's perspective, also important. And that idea of character is seen in a number of different ways. Here we're looking at architecture, what buildings may look like with mixed use on the ground floor and residential or office above, but architectural styles that really are reflective of historic Franklin, but with a twist, recognizing that we're not trying to recreate downtown Main Street. So you can start to see some examples of, you know, these really cool mixed-use buildings, and even some of the things that have been done by our client Market Street in the Gulch, some of these interior courtyards that are exciting for the residents as well. And then looking at smaller scale buildings, even, because we have some townhouses or row houses as part of the development. And so what would those look like? A little bit more of a modern twist on them as well. When we're doing something that is a more mixed use and active environment, the open spaces become really important. And so having them be active and lively, fun for families and, you know, young professionals and seniors and everybody in between is crucial. And so that's something we've been studying as well. And then incorporating public art and activation through murals and art installations and water features and, you know, twinkly bistro lights and doing the buildings and all sorts of things just to make this place a true destination that keeps people interested. And even looking at something that is typically a mundane component of a development, that's, you know, stormwater. How do we take that and add character and make it artful and beautiful as well as functional? And so we've been studying some ways that we can do that. Now, of course, it's not all about pretty pictures. And so with Reagan Smith on the team, you can rest assured that all the technical aspects are thought through as well. So taking those pretty pictures of sustainable stormwater and then working to find out how we incorporate those specifically throughout the plan has been very, very well thought out. Our artist rendering, we've updated some of these. You'll recognize from similar iterations, we've literally had them updated. So if you're used to looking at how they all work out, you'll start to see these connections with the adjacent properties. You'll see the mixed use components, the existing green spaces preserved, how we've broken up and articulated the building facades, and even things like the row houses and stuff in the rear areas become important. This is a new view. Around the main central square here, or triangle, as you may see, with, again, the preserved existing tree canopy. We have, you know, office building components mixed with hotel, mixed use on the ground floor, people living above, and then even incorporating the existing building and some of the civic spaces that tie it into the overall neighborhood as an important part of that. This is a new view that we've created, starting to look into what are some of these plazas and things on the corners start to look like, and how do we incorporate pedestrians and some of the engineering things we've heard. We've worked with engineering to get make sure our curb radius or turning radius are wide enough, but how do we visually make that seem narrower so drivers will go more slowly through here? How do we incorporate civic art and stormwater, and you know, all of these different components become important in the plan. And then the main view into our main street here, having people out sort of outside dining, hanging out, probably a little further apart from each other these days. So we might need to adjust that rendering, but people having businesses that are thriving in the development. And this is an image, we changed this part of the plan in the rear where the townhouses are, but it captured the idea really well, where we have row houses or townhouses that are individual units, but even the larger scale buildings that relate to and address them are even articulated to read as townhouses. So those small details become important to the overall character of the community. I want to run through a list of modifications of standards for you. And the good news is that this is a lot shorter list than the last time we were here because of the new zoning ordinance. And so that's very, very exciting. And the other good news is just as of today, we've gotten rid of modification of standard number one and number two. So we'll skip on to this one here, number three. The crux of this is when you're looking at the one of the provisions where it requires individual entrances to all ground floor units, the idea of that and making an activated streetscape is fundamentally sound and is really important and a good idea. But what we found in looking at how the new ordinance applies to the actual plan, the idea of context becomes important. Also the idea of topography and looking at we have a diagram here to start to show how that works. So we have two concepts, one called consolidated entrances and one called individual entrances. Here in the mixed use areas, you would imagine that they would be consolidated. So you might have one main entrance into some of the larger building portions or in an office component, you'd have a primary entrance and some others if you have ground floor mixed use. But when you start getting into some of the more residential components along the main arteries here, we would want them to also still be consolidated as a more urban looking environment. And then as we get into the less commercial, less mixed use, more residentially focused, having more individual entrances becomes important. Some of this also is based on the topography of the site and the difficulty you get when you're trying to step down the individual entrances. But we agree that overall it's important to have that vitality of the streetscape. And so we're looking for modification of standards to allow for some variation in individual entrances versus consolidated entrances. The next one is modification of standards, looking at the provisions that require on-street parking, sidewalks, and street trees on all streets. We have, as you can see here in green, this is all on-street parking, so nearly the entirety of the development is set up to have it, but there are a few locations where it's difficult to do so or impossible. Here along the outer loop road that we added based on our discussions with engineering and fire, because we want to preserve the existing tree stands here, the dimensional constraints begin to get such that if you have sidewalks on the other side of the street, it ends up making where this isn't a viable block in a couple of other locations. And then as you move further to the back of the property, while we anticipate buildings facing out onto the green spaces and the sustainable stormwater methods that are here, we don't want to necessarily have on-street parking that is beyond what we need in this farther reach of the project. So we don't want people parking random things like boats and trailers and all of that. It has to be policed all the time. So in some of our discussions with staff, we've gone back and added in more than we were anticipating initially. And so hopefully this resolves the issue. Another MOS we're looking at is, and this one is more for our sake, because right now there's a requirement that you can't have wall-mounted mechanical utilities or refuse areas that are visible from primary locations, but it says whenever possible. And so we could say, well, that's great. Everybody agrees that whenever possible, it's not possible in certain locations, so forget it. What we'd like to do is actually go ahead and get that locked down. And so we have this concept of primary and secondary frontages. The primary frontages are in pink and the secondary are in blue. And as you can see, this would have the bulk of those sort of not as exciting portions of a streetscape limited to the outer edge. And then on the core, we have the primary frontages where you wouldn't have any of those. And actually the language we proposed actually makes it where these are always left as primary. There's a little bit of flexibility in the other ones. The rest of these have to do with signage. And we know that signage is a hot topic in the city, but part of the reason why MOSs are allowed is to, you know, something that is unique or special or relevant to a particular project. And one of the things that we want in this project is to have it be funky and different and quirky and special. And so what we're looking at is allowing some of these signs, I call them icon signs, where it's basically, you know, it's a cool tea shop and they have a teapot, that's their sign. I would think that you wouldn't want this on every building. It would become a little bit cluttered looking, but having the ability to do it in some cases, I think would be really exciting. So we've asked for that. Another one is a provision that requires or prohibits band signs on buildings that have wall signs. And so we're looking at asking for the idea that if we have some on some of our larger buildings, main corporate tenants, that we can have also a band sign in addition to a wall sign and blade signs and things that would relate to other uses, or even this same tenant, you know, how do you get into their space, find their space? And you can see historically they would do this all the time. And here's a bunch of different versions of that. So we're asking for some relief on that. We're also looking to have internal illumination allowed on canopy signs in the way that they used to do it on beautiful historic buildings. And so that's pretty straightforward. Looking at hanging signs as well, right now they're limited to three square feet maximum size. And so we'd like it to be 6 square feet. If you start looking around at beautiful main streets all around the country, signs are a little bit larger than 3 square feet. And also allowing them to be artfully internally illuminated. So that would be important as well. The next one is related to blade signs, vertical blade signs, which are these types of signs. Right now, you're very, very limited to how where you can use them, how much you can use them. And so what we're looking at is a way to incorporate a little bit more flexibility in that, maybe have, you know, a couple per facade allowed on a streetscape. But everyone would agree that if you go too far with these or do too many, that it wouldn't look necessarily very good. And then this is basically the inverse of that band sign, because they were mutually exclusive, wall signs and band signs. This is just saying we want to use wall signs with band signs and vice versa. And then the last one, this is more of an engineering MOS, and this will show up on our engineering memo. But here there's a prohibition. We got a comment back saying that we can't have on-street parking within 30 feet of the flow line of a T intersection like this. And so we're just requesting that we get some relief on that. You can see it throughout downtown Franklin, through West Haven, all sorts of locations throughout the city. And we'd like to incorporate that as well, because we don't want our intersections to be so wide that people just speed through willy-nilly. And you see it only happens in 3 locations in the project. So that's the end of the very fast lightning round. Thank you for your attention, and happy to go over any questions that you all have.
All right, thank you very much, Brian. Staff, is there anything that you want to comment on before we ask for public comments?
Yes, this is Joey, planner assigned to Eastworks. I'll try to keep mine brief, my remarks brief, just because I know there's a lot of people that want to have their own remarks. The plan overall does meet a lot of the guidelines and principles of Envision Franklin, and we're very thankful for that. They've done a lot of work over the past few years to really get this to be something, you know, very special. As far as the modification of standards, there are a few that we're still kind of discussing internally, but I can kind of give you our initial feedback just from a staff perspective. Looking at number 3 with the individual entrances, the zoning ordinance asks for individual entrances for dwelling units on the ground floor to make it more of a pedestrian oriented feel, which I think, and they're asking for MOS for portions of the site, which could be appropriate given certain topographic issues, but we need more information on that. And I think some of the buildings that they showed in the graphic were more office or mixed use with ground floor commercial retail uses, so it wouldn't even apply to that MOS. Same with number four, we're going to be discussing that with engineering as well for the streetscape modification request. For number five, the ground utilities, staff can support that because when your whole building is facing different roadways, it's really hard to put them somewhere else. So we can support that. As far as the sign section of the zoning ordinance was heavily overhauled along with the zoning ordinance, as we all know, that was passed in the last year. So the shape signs, unique shape signs staff would not support, as well as the canopy special interior illuminated lighting, staff could not support that. However, due to the context of the development and the scale and the kind of different buildings, we could support the wall sign and the band signs. We want to put some more thought into that and kind of limiting the amount of wall signage on the taller or higher levels, because we don't want to just kind of fill up everything with signage. Let's see what else. Blade signs, we could also support more than one. Just our conversation today, we were thinking two per frontage, locating them at intersections, or no more than two per frontage, limiting them at intersections and massing changes of the buildings. For number nine, the hanging sign, size of the hanging sign, we want a bit more information and more maybe contextual pictures, images, to see if 6 feet is appropriate when compared to entrances or fenestration patterns, windows, that sort of thing. So that's a kind of planning's viewpoint from the modification of requests. I can answer any questions from other commissioners, aldermen, when that time comes. I know Jimmy Wiseman wanted to address something, so I'll give it over to Jimmy.
Thanks, Joey. Brian, if you would, I know we've talked a lot about it, but the units over the streets, could you touch on that a little bit just so we can get that in front of everybody? And the on-street parking portion, we'll work through those. Typically, that's a safety issue for people that may blow through a stop sign, and we don't typically want parked cars or worse than that, a pedestrian getting out of a car in that situation. So we'll continue to work through that with the development team.
Can you hear me? All right, so in this location, we're showing we're calling a connector between these two buildings. So it'd be, you know, it's really interesting, kind of bridge over. And so just make a unique location there. We had initially intended to actually have residential units above there. That's our preference. But it's kind of been going through discussions. It seems like there's a engineering and fire would prefer to have just a literal pedestrian connection over that. We had another one in a prior iteration of the plan. Right now we're just showing one, and I'll show you what it looks like here in the rendering. So you can see that right there. So you drive underneath.
And additionally, I'll add that we did meet at the work session to discuss the impacts on traffic. And obviously that'll be a continuing conversation as we come to the Planning Commission and board with this plan. And there are lots of improvements associated with this and some level of service issues that we'll work through. If you got any questions about that, we can talk about those as well. Thank you.
Thank you guys very much. We will now, I'm gonna go down through the list of folks that are in the meeting, and I may read some that are not here, and you can just be silent if you're not here. But I'm gonna read down through this list and you guys can comment, and you can just say no comment if you don't have a comment. But we'll start with Marcia Allen. Any comments to give to the applicant?
Not at this time, maybe later.
Okay. Jimmy Franks?
No comment.
Scott Harrison?
Not at this time.
Roger Lindsay. Roger, he's not here, I guess. Okay, we'll move to Alma McLemore.
Nothing at this time.
Okay, Michael Orr?
I didn't hear the applicant mention anything about parking garages within each building. Is that where the majority of the parking is going to take place for each one of the individual buildings?
It is, yes. There's a number of parking lots, parking garages distributed throughout each block. So we don't have all the parking load. People are coming in and out, just focus on one area. So it's a very distributed pattern, which works really well for the traffic flow.
And is a portion of that shared or not?
Yes, we've taken full advantage of the shared parking factors, and in a mixed use environment, you know, you really, that's the way to go. So we definitely want to have shared parking.
That's all I have.
Okay, thank you, Michael. Ms. Peterson.
Yes, now that I've unmuted. Wait, just a minute.
You're good. Yeah, well, I can hear you.
Okay, great. Did I understand you to say, whenever you started talking about the modification standards, that you have decided not to request the modification of standards for the garage dimensions? I mean, the particular place for a vehicle?
Correct. Yes.
Okay. So you've let that go. Okay. Thank you.
And number one and number two.
Okay. So because that was not going to work for vehicles. Thank you.
All right. Ms. Szilagyi.
One question I had. I know it was an item that it sounded like the staff was still perhaps going to work through as far as the consolidated entry. Are those going to be, do we know if they're going to be condos or apartments?
Dirk, do you want to cover that?
Sure. Good question. We anticipate a mix of those. It's a little too early in the planning process to know what the demand in the market is for those, but I think we'd like to see a variety of housing types, both by for sale and for ownership and by price. So that would be our goal.
And then the only other, the comment I had would be just on the different shape signs. I know that's something that staff would not be in favor of. And just kind of my personal comment on that is sometimes they can be really fun, but you can kind of get like a Broadway type feel, you know? So I probably wouldn't be in favor of that because you don't quite know where they're going to go. I'd say too on the increase of the hanging sign from 3 feet to 6 feet, I think it'd probably be contacts. And, you know, if each little retail place has, you know, 6 foot blade sign, you know, versus 3 foot, you know, it's kind of density and disbursement that would probably make a effect on that. I also just had a question for staff as well, as far as the illuminated canopy signs. From inside, I understand that, but is there any particular reason why?
As far as illuminated lines or signs, I believe it's only externally illuminated, but I'll have to check on that just to be sure. I think that was just the preference that we received, just both professionally and from the public, going through the ordinance update last year.
Okay, thank you. And that's all.
All right. Thank you. Ms. Berger, any comments?
Yes, just a couple. Yeah.
Which one are you calling?
Bev Berger.
Can you hear me?
Yep. Mark?
Okay. Yeah, hold on 1 second, Mark. I'm getting Bev to say what she has, what comments she's got.
Are we good? Okay.
Yes.
Love this technology. It's great. Okay. Yeah. So I have a lot of interesting questions, but I'm going to probably hold some of them. But I what I love about this development, first of all, let me just say, I think there's been a lot of thought going to this. I think there's a lot of creativity here. There is a lot of variety here. And I love that because this is the first big redevelopment in Cool Springs. And I think we need to be thinking outside the box. And also this development is not sitting out on a main street. Carruthers, of course, is a very busy street, but this development is more internal. So I think what happens in this development, and you know, I'm a very visual person, and what happens in this development is going to be very, very unique. So I know that we have a new zoning ordinance that, Brian, you help write, and that there are a lot of things in here that some modifications that they're asking for. And actually, those things just jumped out at me and said, quality, interesting, unique, not your everyday mundane redevelopment. And I love it because I'm seeing a lot of interesting things here. And when I think of those signs, I think it was the those unique signs. I think we were on, what number was that? Number, modification six. These signs just jumped out to me and said, yeah, I felt like I was down in Buford. Really a sense of place, a unique place. Some places that if we have things like this, we have some illuminated signs. I'm not a big fan of a lot of the longer signs, the banner signs. I think sometimes, I think Jen or somebody said that it can be, maybe get a little bit more like, you know, a bigger city kind of look. But I think there's a place for some of those. And I think we should really be open to looking at how this place fits together in a unique mixed use, different kind of first redevelopment that we've actually seen in Cool Springs. So I have a tendency to go with some of these things because it says to me, wow, unique and interesting. And I think it's done, the things you've shown in here, some of the examples I think are very tastefully done. And I think they're very unique, but tastefully done. And I think a variety, wouldn't want to see them all over everywhere, but even the lighting done correctly. Montebello Hotel, the way that is unique around the one strip. Anyway, I just wanted to speak to that because it's jumped out to me. I think the row houses, there's an opportunity there as you look at that to put on some rooftop areas. Go down to Ludlow Row, right there by Germantown. There's a three-story row house with their rooftops that the people can use. I think usable space in these kinds of developments are really important. The other thing, I agree with the maybe at the end of the street that you don't park vehicles at the end of that street where there's a T. The only other comments I have were, let's see. I guess that's about it. But I guess that's probably it. I've got a few more, but I'm going to reserve those to later. But I just thought there was a lot of variety. We need variety in this town. And we need, when we're doing redevelopment, I want us to really think, where is this? Keep in mind, where is this place? This is not downtown Franklin. This is in the Cool Springs area of Franklin. And it's, we're developing more urban centers in the Cool Springs area. And these are very unique developments because they are mixed use. We've got everything you want in there. You've got retail and you've got office and you've got commercial and you've got hotels and you've got rentals and you have for purchase, residential for purchase, walking trails, outside space, you name it. So I think that we have to be planning department with the ordinance and everything. I think we have make sure that we are going to give this kind of development the uniqueness it deserves. And that's all my comments.
Thank you, Beth. Scott, Speedy?
I'd be curious, just like Jimmy Wiseman said, just to see what some of the road impact fees and what some of the road improvements are going to be in this area. I also think, and I'm assuming they've probably talked to them, but like the Franklin Transit Authority could be a really valuable, upgrade for this area versus right now. I kind of view it as a nice quality of life, heavily subsidized entity versus now can actually move some people in a very efficient manner in the Cool Springs area. Second, I can't remember if we ever talked about what the impact would be for schools, the number of students. And then my final comment would be, I probably agree with Alderman Berger on the sign. I don't know what's pretty and what's not. Maybe we just need to get Brian Mulligan on some of that the signing language and the zoning ordinance.
All right, thank you. Margaret?
No, you're running short of time, so I'm going to talk to Brian later with my questions, but I do want to thank him for this presentation. It was great, and you know how I feel about your work, Brian. I just, I think you did it, and I appreciate it, and I'll go talk with you about my questions later.
Thank you, Margaret. Mayor Moore?
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity to say something. I think my first takeaway was I really had a real sense of place making as Brian went through his presentation there. And I had a sense that it was a place that I'd like to go visit. And I think it was because of just all the variety that I was seeing. And some of it was because of the signage. And I think, I would never want it to look like Lower Broadway for sure. But I think some of the ideas they have about signage have to be looked at as far as the context of where they're at and so on. But I can see that they would create some a unique feel in that area. I'm excited for the redevelopment of this area. I think it's a bold plan. I can't keep up with all the modification standards because I can't pull all those up with all your pictures, and I'd rather look at you rather than that. I think traffic is going to be one of the real challenges, and I know I've been in some meetings talking about some of the traffic solutions there, but congratulations on a great design and a great feel, and we look forward to continuing to work with you on this.
Thank you. Roger, I know we missed you earlier. Any comments?
Yeah, I haven't seen all the details on the modifications of standards, but are you able to meet the city's stormwater requirements without the need for any kind of a variance? Or?
Yes, we are. The current plan does meet the current standards.
All right, thank you. So, Emily, any public comments we need to add?
No, we don't have anybody on the phone line, and we didn't receive any email comments for this item either.
Okay, good.
Can I make a quick comment?
Yes, please.
I just want to say that when I've met with them, because this is in my district, my ward, so I've been very interested in how this all plays out. And there is a pretty extensive, I've been very pleased to look at their, when we met, the infrastructure that you plan, the intersections at Baker Bridge, and I know you'll get into this later, and the intersection at Cool Springs, and some of the modification, some of the road work that you're gonna do, and even for the new extension of getting on the interstate, there's a lot of extensive work that they're putting into the road work. Mm-hmm. So I'm really pleased to see that, because traffic and how you mitigate that and work with it over there is going to be very important.
Mike, if I could make one more comment.
Please.
Yeah. I would echo Alderman Speedy's comments about the transit. I mean, this is going to be an area where transit could really be a real asset as we look how much traffic is there. So just encourage them to make sure they're including that in their development and how it would interact with our Transit Authority.
Good, thank you.
And possibly even how it would interact with maybe a transit going to Nashville.
Okay. Thank you. All right. Thank you, guys. We're going to move on to item number three now. This is a discussion of a development plan proposing 5,500 square feet of commercial, 7,900 square feet of restaurant, 4,420 square feet of office, 243 multifamily dwelling units, and 21.24 acres on 21.24 acres located at the intersection of South Royal Oaks Boulevard and Oak Meadow Drive. We'll now turn the screen over to the applicant, and then I'll open up for discussion.
Hey guys, Bradley, thanks for hearing our presentation tonight. We, like Dirk before me, it's a hard act to follow because that was a great development, and we're looking forward to presenting a similar mixed-use development in a completely different area. And Ms. Berger, I think, said it appropriately. Each area needs to be unique, and we think we've planned a unique development for this corridor of Franklin, and we're excited to show it off to you. And so we've got a presentation prepared here that we'd like to share with you.
Okay, I think I'm off of mute now. You'll hear me okay?
Yes.
I see Amy nodding.
I hear you.
Well, I really just want to say thank you, Mike. Thank you, Planning Commission, Board Mayor and Alderman, for making this possible for us to present and continue to move forward. We have been very engaged with our neighbors during this planning process. We've had now over six neighborhood meetings and continue to meet with small groups within the area to show our plan, refine our plan, and it has really been an engaging process. Over the past few months, we have spent a lot of time looking at what we've identified as the number one issue, which is traffic impact, roadway improvements, and we'll be spending some time talking about that this evening. Just to reorient you, there are two properties that are remaining to be developed in the Watson Glen subdivision. They total 35.2 acres. The property that is along I-65 will remain Regional Commerce RC6. We're not proposing a rezoning of that property. We do expect that over time it will develop out with office uses, commercial, potentially hotel use. In the next few weeks, we'll be submitting construction documents for the extension of Riverside Drive, connecting it to Oak Meadow Drive, and look forward to starting that, that construction. We're talking tonight about the 19.6 acres that's just south of Oak Meadow Drive. Here it's currently zoned RC6. We're requesting a rezoning to PD, Planned Development District. The Envision Franklin policy on the property is neighborhood mixed use. The primary uses do include local commercial, multifamily residential, professional office. The character of development in neighborhood mixed use is to bring the building up to the street to create a very pedestrian oriented environment and to create a relationship with office and multifamily residential where we create a lively neighborhood with restaurants, shops, stores. Parking is encouraged to be behind the building, but it's also encouraged to be on street. And we're looking at how to address those issues as they relate to Envision Franklin and the policies moving forward for this area. This is the overall master plan showing how along I-65 there could be commercial uses, and we're focusing here just south of Oak Meadow Drive. The master plan includes a strong architectural element of a restaurant here at the corner of Oak Meadow Drive and Royal Oaks Boulevard. The majority of the architecture at this intersection, or I should say all of the architecture at this intersection, is one story. We have the miles across the street and the gas station, so we're keeping that one-story restaurant here anchored on the corner. We have three mixed-use buildings transitioning down Oak Meadow Drive, and the last two buildings here are residential buildings. The blue areas that you're seeing are office suites that are incorporated on the first floor. The purple area that you're seeing here is the fitness club and the management offices, the residential club facilities for the multifamily. So a typical building elevation would include a ground floor that really resembles and is activated as those commercial uses down on the ground floor. This is the fitness club building and the residence club side adjacent to the swimming pool. And you can see here the commercial mixed use areas are highlighted at the ends of the buildings with arcade and overhangs with residential above. So the side of the building facing Oak Meadow Drive are three-story buildings. There'll be four-story buildings on the backside, so we're using those buildings to transition the grades toward the parking areas. The darker blue area that you're seeing here underneath, that is the 100-year floodplain, and we're respecting that line. We do have a little bit of manipulation where we have some parking geometry that we're working with, but we're trying to keep that 100-year floodplain line where it is. That was one of the concerns that neighborhoods, we received in neighborhood input, and we want to respect that for sure. So this is the corner of the first building adjacent to the swimming pool with the restaurants over here on the right side. The restaurant will have an outdoor area right at the corner. That's a very pedestrian area, and we want to have it to be as inviting as possible. And so we're putting that outdoor dining right out here. It'll be underneath this covered canopy roof of the restaurant. We'll have additional outdoor dining along the side of the restaurant here that will be inviting as you're crossing the pedestrian bridge from the amenity area of the swimming pool and the club across the pedestrian bridge to the restaurant. So very strong relationship and strong connection there. This will be more of a sit-down family-style restaurant. We'll also have a more faster, casual restaurant here with a drive-through, and that's to continue that architectural presence down Royal Oak Boulevard. Also from our neighborhood meetings, we received input that there's really not a great, or there's not a passive park within this area of Franklin, and a lot of the residents asked if we would consider putting aside the land as a public park with public access. We will have a half-mile walking loop that's inside of this 10-acre park, but we'll leave these open spaces. The development will maintain these spaces, so they'll be maintained, will not be maintained by the city, but maintained by the private developer, and will be open to the public for access. We have multiple pedestrian connections to it along Oak Meadow and, of course, over here at Royal Oaks. So the number one issue that we have heard from in the community is, what are you going to do about traffic? To Margaret's previous point, says that this is kind of an infill. So now what are you going to do to address additional traffic density on the roadways? These intersections that are circled here were studied by Reagan Smith's traffic engineers. Our traffic report turned into the city of Franklin has been reviewed by the third party reviewer and has been reviewed by Adam Mosher, the city's traffic engineer. So we've had a lot of input on this. It's been multiple months of digesting the information and the research, and we feel like we're headed in a pretty good direction today. So this is the morning AM peak hour intersection grades along Royal Oaks and at Highway 96. This is not today's score. This is the score in 2024. After typical growth would occur, not including our development proposal. So this has additional vehicles added to each of the intersections beyond what we're proposing. You'll see here at Royal Oaks and Highway 96 in 2024, it will operate at level service D in the morning. In the evening, PM peak hour, we have a lot more vehicles that are coming in off of I-65 to this location, using it to get home. And today, or in 2024, it operates at a level service F. In 2024, this intersection here drops to a level of service E. You'll see that in both the AM and the PM, these intersections at Watson Glen and Rand Place both function at a level service F. And then we have Forest Crossing at level service D and Matt Catcher at level service E. So this stretch of road is one of the first areas that we analyzed, discovered that with signal timing corrections that we can improve these intersections to accommodate additional vehicle trips to this stretch of roadway. For South Royal Oaks Boulevard, we currently have two left lanes turning toward downtown. We only need one. There is not enough traffic to warrant two turn lanes in this location. So we're converting one of those turn lanes to a through lane, and we'll be adding a third right turn lane here on Royal Oaks to turn into the three lanes of traffic here headed toward I-65. We're going to be extending the turn lanes well past their current starting point, which is about here, well on back to Wells Fargo. These are the two failing intersections that I pointed out for in front of Aldi and at Rand Place. The recommendation here is to convert this intersection into a left turn only, so that you can't cut across from Publix to Aldi. The other is to completely remove the intersection here at Rand Place and extend the left turn lane out. For both of these, if you want to make a left turn out onto Royal Oaks from the Publix side, we're telling people they need to go to the signalized intersections. So they'll have to go to Oak Meadow Drive, or they'll have to go to the next road up, which is here. So instead of cutting across here, you just have to drive over here to Einstein's, where the signalized intersection is. So this is the morning peak hour results. You'll see here in this first column, 2019, those are today's scores at each one of the intersections that we just looked at. The 2024 has the background, and these are the scores I was showing you. So you can see the change after we've added the 2024 background traffic. And then the last column here is the 2024 score of that intersection with our development and with the improvements being made as well. So at each of these intersections, we feel very confident that we are keeping up with the 2024 projected growth and mitigating our additional traffic that we're adding to Royal Oaks and Highway 96 in the morning. In the evening, very similar story here. We still have an F intersection with all of the traffic that's headed out from the north onto Highway 96. However, with our signal timing changes, we're actually improving it by about 4 seconds of delay at that location. With Highway 96 and Royal Oaks, again, with the laneage improvements that we're talking about making in 2024 without our development, it's still an E with 60.2 seconds. It will be an E after our improvements with 59.4 seconds of delay. Talk a little bit about Matt Catcher. Matt Catcher is under design right now by the state of Tennessee, and the city engineering department, I believe, would prefer that any improvements come at that time when the state of Tennessee does the improvements for Mac Hatchers. So did want to show you the results and the change of that intersection at Royal Oaks and Mac Hatcher, but as of today, we're not improving that intersection. Our arterial road impact fees generated by this development totaled $1.7 million. The mixed-use development Vintage would contribute $850,000 of that, the commercial development about $900,000 of that. And our proposal is to keep all of these improvements that we're talking about doing within this $1.7 million total cost. One safety consideration that we have been talking with the engineering department about is this stretch of road, again, between Royal Oaks and I-65. In the past 2 years, from 2017 to 2019, there have been a total of 105 vehicle accidents. 95 of those are property damage, and thankfully there have been no incapacitating injuries or fatalities. But this stretch of road has 3.38 times the state average of wrecks with four lanes and a turn lane. And vehicles are stopping traffic, backing traffic up, trying to turn into these businesses that are on the north and south side of this stretch of road. The proposal is to put in a 5 foot wide grass median along this stretch of road to prevent those vehicles from turning either north or south at mid-block. Again, this is a safety consideration. This improvement does not change the capacity or change the scores of the intersections that I just showed you, but it is something that could be paid for using the arterial road impact fee money. So with the mixed-use development, the PD plan on the south side of Oak Meadow, we would be able to afford and pay for all of the lanage improvements that you're seeing here. So all of the improvements along Oak Meadow Drive, all of the improvements along Royal Oaks, as well as the signal timing on 96 at these two intersections. So that addresses and takes care of those capacity related items. The commercial development would then be responsible for paying for improvements at Riverside Drive and the Riverside Drive extension down to Oak Meadow Drive, so we get the loop around the Watson Glen subdivision. And if the safety consideration was to move forward, that would be a part of that responsibility as well. So with that, I'm happy to answer your questions. I know Ross Bradley is still on with us as well, and representing TDK, and so we're here to answer questions that you may have.
All right, thank you. Staff, do we have any comments?
Yeah, I just want to say the staff can support this from planning standpoint. It does meet the standards for mixed use in Envision Franklin. They've worked with us on some issues for their frontage types. They were able to fix that. They're not asking for any kind of modification of standards in this development plan. But let me turn it over to Jimmy, because I know engineering does have some comments.
Thanks, Diana. Mm-hmm. As Greg mentioned, we've spent many, many months working through this traffic impact analysis, and what we've come up with is a pretty good plan for mitigating the impact and reducing some of the delay that exists today. So we've, the way Greg kind of mapped out the improvements, we understand that if we approach the improvement on 96, that's much more of a controversial type improvement, even given the safety improvement that it does provide due to the limited access for connectivity for some of those businesses. Long-term, it's certainly something that's needed, but along Royal Oaks, that would be a separate type discussion with those businesses, and a little bit less controversial because you're able to get vehicles to the retail developments there, and then they can find their way out through signalized intersections. We actually have really good connectivity over there. So over the next several weeks, the plan is to have several meetings with the property owners in this region to discuss these improvements prior to the plan coming before Planning Commission. I believe that's the plan, and Greg, correct me if I'm wrong, but that's where we were heading at this point.
All right, thank you guys. So we're about 25 minutes till the next meeting. So we need to, as I'm going through these questions or comments, requests, if you can keep your comments as succinct as possible, that would be great. And I will start with Marcia. Any comments?
No comments at this time.
Okay. Jimmy?
Yeah, I've got quite a few, but I'll have to address them at the Planning Commission, I'm sure. I'm more concerned about the unintended consequences of the of what is being projected on 96 from Royal Oaks back to Interstate. Being a property owner through there and aligned with many other property owners on the north side and the south side of 96, you know, the study paints a picture of just what it takes to get down to the applicant site. It doesn't really tell us a mile to the east from that area of traffic on over the interstate. Where do people go down to turn around, make U-turns if that medium's put in place? A mile to the west back towards Franklin, how far do you go down before you make a U-turn to come back in if that grass medium's installed? I know Jimmy Wiseman, we talked a long time ago about the possibility of a signal light that's synchronized with the light that sits up there by Zaxby and the light that Royal Oaks, if the bank builds, and we redevelop the bank in addition to the showings through there. Those intersections are consolidated, which really helps, and it brings it down far enough away from the intersection to that's rough, approximately the same distance that the light down at Zaxby's happens to be. And then it also keeps it off the stacking lane where people stack up to go onto the interstate. So at once upon a time, I think you had commented that there could be an area there that a signalization could be determined. You know, obviously there's enough vehicles there for the warrants, but I think that we don't need to be considered unless it's just some fees that go towards the improvements of whatever happens. So I like the project, but I don't want to be I want to be considerate to the properties, the traffic that is entering our economic engine there from that's over a 3 mile stretch and not just you know, 2,000 yards. I mean, that makes sense.
Yes. Thank you, Jimmy.
Thank you.
Scott Harrison.
I have no comments at this time.
Roger.
Sure, I just have a stormwater question. it's a kind of the last of the natural wild areas down through this area, and I just want to make sure that we're replacing a lot of green leaves and tree trunks and probably scruffy hackberries, but we're replacing them with a lot of impervious surface. So I just want to make sure we're protecting that drainage way and you haven't mentioned any need for any variances or anything like that. I just want to make that point.
All right. Thank you, Roger. Alma?
Are all of these going to be apartments, the residential part?
Yes, the residential part's proposed to be apartments.
Have you thought about any townhomes or any for sale units? I mean, we have a need for those. And then also I was going to ask about the anticipated number of students that would be entering the Franklin Special and Williamson County School District.
Sure. Based upon the, I'll answer the school one first, based upon the analysis and comparison that we have done with other multifamily apartments that are predominantly one and two bedroom, we believe we're going to generate between 10 and 12 students total. Regarding the for rent or for sale, I don't disagree with you. We have a need in the city of Franklin for for sale condominium. For this developer, we're proposing that they be for rent. And that has a lot to do with really the kind of the mixed use nature with the office and the apartments.
Okay, thank you.
Sure.
Alma, any more?
No, that's it.
Okay.
Traffic, he's already talked about traffic, so.
Okay. Michael?
No additional comments.
All right. And Peterson?
No additional comments.
Okay, thank you. Jennifer?
No additional comments.
Ms. Berger?
Real quick, I'd echo if there could be some for sales in there. You know, I just think we get way too many condensed areas with rents, and if we could do some for sales, that would be very helpful. The other thing is, Greg, I have two questions for you. Why is the fitness center in the community space? Seems to me it's down further. It's down near Royal Oaks rather than up near the residential. And then I got another question for you real quick.
Sure. So at the intersection of Royal Oaks, we've looked at the pool being in some other locations. And I believe Michael Orr mentioned, asked us to consider looking at it in some other locations. But over there at the Miles Auto Center, everything there is one story, so it's very low profile. The scale of the buildings really don't change until you get back to our first building where you have Summerbee and you have the four-story elevations. So it feels more in context where we have it, plus we're creating a real special environment there where residents can engage with the restaurant, the pool, and the social club, and so it's all kind of neatly tucked in there together for as an amenity.
All right. Well, okay. And then the other thing is, did they ever consider some small parking garages, like 2 and 3 story parking garages, to go along with that rather than doing all this surface parking that just seems to get really a lot of surface parking?
Well, the linear nature of the property, because it's so long, to focus a parking garage in just one area of the site really didn't seem conducive to spreading the parking out over the longer distance. And realizing for our parking lot, we only have 2 bays. It's not a giant commercial parking lot or big giant office parking lot. It's just very long and linear along the streetscape.
So how many residential units are supposed to be there?
There are 245 total.
Well, I was just saying in the back, rather than all that service parking, could be a parking, even a 2-story parking garage or 3 for the residential. Then the only other comment I had was that we do, Jimmy, we have to do something about that park, that Murfreesboro Road in 96. And I know that's another discussion for later, but we have some issues there that really need to be addressed, but that's all my comments. Thanks.
All right. Thank you. Dana, I see you joined us. Any comments?
No comments. Thank you.
All right. Scott Speedy.
Yeah, I'll just reiterate. I've been to multiple of these neighborhood meetings and always the number one concern is the traffic. So it's nice to see the traffic impact study and Jimmy Wiseman and making some improvements to those intersections.
Okay. Thank you. Ms. Martin.
No comments.
All right. Thank you. Mayor Moore. All right. Then any public comment, staff?
No, we didn't have any emails and no one's on the phone line.
Okay, then if there's no other comments, I think we're adjourned for this meeting and we'll readjourn in 15 minutes for the main planning commission meeting. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mike.